Guys, the screen is visible.
Yes, the screen is visible.
Great. So here is the agenda. I will start with the product management basics. Then we'll try to cover what are types of product managers based on their different roles and the domain. There are different type of product managers which are based on the needs of the industry. There are different product manager roles which are currently available. Some of them are at the entry level, and some of them is as and when you keeps on growing in the schedule path. We'll cover the skill sets also, which is required for the product managers, preferable skill sets. There's no hard boundary because currently this role is, I think, still evaluating and evolving over the time. So I think that skills are not very hard bound, but we'll try to cover at least a few of the basic demands. Then we'll look at the career opportunities. What can you expect in the PM interviews? Then I have also added two product sample use cases. We'll take it with you so that you guys can have a first-hand experience of what kind of expectation that you have, or what kind of questions that you might have while facing one of the PM interviews. A brief intro about me. I think Apurva has already done, but here's my LinkedIn profile. I have around 6+ years of work experience now in the industry. Currently, I'm working with Flipkart as a product manager. And before that, I was working with OYO as a senior product manager. So pretty much about the engineering product management experience overall. So well-versed with all the technical terminologies, but also on the pre-sale side. So what is product management? So as per the definition, the way we define us is product management is an organization function within a company who deals with the new product development, planning, verification, forecasting, pricing, and product launch. So there are multiple jargons here. I will go over it one by one. When we say new product development, so this is where all the ideation part is. Let's say you want to solve some problem. Let's say whenever Swiggy are trying to enter into India, and whenever they're launching in India, what they might be facing is the first part is ideation. What kind of problem they are trying to solve? They might want to solve the late night deliveries. They might want to solve the quicker deliveries. They want to solve those customers who don't want to visit to restaurants. So these are the kind of problems that you first address while building a product. So that is a part of our new product development part. Then we also do the planning. Once your idea is conceptualized, then you start doing your planning. Okay, now since you started doing, okay, you want to do the late night delivery. Let's say a company called Swiggy is wanted to do a 11 p.m. night delivery. So what kind of planning is required? You need delivery executives, you need their commission incentives. You want to spend some time on marketing, how you will reach out to customer, how you retain those customer. So such kind of parts, which all functions you are going to impact, that covers in the part of planning. Verification is you test your ideas also. You reach out to customer, you call, you do the interviews also. You do some kind of secondary research also, and you try to validate your idea, whether the hypothesis that you are building is it really a pain point? Maybe 11 p.m. delivery is not such a pain point because just 100 customers are delivering after 11 p.m. Maybe the actual delivery is at the 9 a.m. breakfast. So how your ideation will change is a part of verification, where you test your ideas based on the customer interviews, based on secondary research, based on your responses from the product. All such part comes under verification. Then after launch, you also do some kind of forecasting. What is the demand prediction looks like? Maybe peak hour demand will be much higher, so you want to plan the delivery executives much more at the time of evening than obviously at late night. So such kind of forecasting where you are predicting the demand on hourly basis, on monthly basis. Maybe in Diwali, metros are very like act like a ghost town. So obviously demand will shift from Gurgaon to maybe some tier two town. So such kind of part we'll cover in forecasting. Then comes pricing. What is the right pricing strategy for your product? How much you should charge, which is delivering the value to your customer, but also delivering the value to your organization, because you have to pay incentive. Again, the Swiggy example, you have to pay commission to your delivery agents. You want them to the entire tech stack you are building. You want to pay salaries also to your employees. Apart from all this, and you are also spending something into marketing. In all this delta spending, what are the value benefit that you should charge to the customer so that you can cover all the pricing point and maybe building some value benefit out of it? So whether you should charge 30 rupees per delivery, you should charge 40 rupees per delivery, or you should charge a subscription fees, such as all very much a core part of product management. And the last part is product launch, how the product launch should look like. This part includes the product communication, this part includes the product marketing, and this part finally includes the brand communication. So product managers really work with marketing team, digital marketing team. They work with very closely with the brand team, and they are the one who actually communicate what is the true benefit for the customer by after the launch of this product. So these are the different facets where product managers comes into picture. As you see, these are not just one vertical, these are different vertical. That's why I always say product management is always a horizontal construct where you are interacting with a different organization, different people within the organization, and you try and coordinate with them. And that is why our stakeholders are so high. Maybe within a week, we interact with 10 to 12 different different stakeholders. One with the engineering side, maybe one on the business side, how much sales side, then on the marketing side, then on the brand side. So that is the overall product management profiles looks like when you try to interact with different people. This is one of the very popular Venn diagram. Whenever you see, if you do Google about product management, where product manager is actually the sub function of three different part. Where PM is a part of wears three hat. We say hat because as per the audience, you change your terminology, you change your jargons. So when you are targeting with business will ask you how much sales will this feature will provide. Why should we launch this feature? What is the ROI? Whether I get a 100 crore business out of this, whether I get a 50 crore business, or how much is a break-even point? So such kind of decisions while interacting with the business, you are the co-owning. You co-own those business metrics. And, sorry, any question in that?
No, I think you can go on.
No issue. Okay. Okay, so while talking with business, you co-own those business metrics and you try to deliver such targets, maybe 30 crore per month or 50 crore per month, whatever the business values are there. Then you also try to interact with your tech stakeholders, where you interact with them. Okay, how much time it required to build this feature? How many engineers do you need? How many designers do you need? Okay, how the screen should look like? So when I say tech has two part. One is obviously your engineering stakeholders, engineers, and also the second stakeholders can be your product designers, where you day to day interact with them. How the product home screen should look like? What kind of button should look like? And what kind of color and overall theme should look like? Okay, for example, let's say if a website is a very one of the product that I have built is related to weddings. Okay, so a wedding customer, where we have seen the kind of traffic that we are getting, 70% of them are female traffic. So obviously the female traffic looks for much more variety as far as our interview is concerned. So we made our product much more bulkier. We made our product with lot of categorization. Okay, instead of if it has been a much more men centric product, then maybe the theme would be very, very standard set of examples where men can hop on. So again, these are the kind of insights and hat that you wear while talking to a tech stakeholder. And the last are the customer. You day on day interact with the customers, you measure their metrics, you try to have one-on-one interviews with them. We have focus group discussions with them. So to understand what is the pain point they are having, what is the pain point they are having currently, maybe the product while you are ideating, and even after the launch, what is currently not working for them, how can you improve them? So that is the third aspect of it. Why this is important is I think product manager is the only person in the entire organization who cares about the customer. Business says that, oh, I want quicker sale, let's just launch the product whatever stage this is in. Tech says, no, I want to build a very right set with the very right architecture. I'm going to release the product. And then marketing team says, okay, I have a target. Let's just run some campaign with at the very low ad cost, where we'll offer something free. Okay. And we'll get all the traffic. Okay. And then the brand will say, okay, I have also a target there. I want to launch some of the communication to my customer, and I want to launch it quickly. You are probably the only one who should be saying, no. This is cover. This is what customer needs. This is what we have in tech. This is what I want to achieve in the business, and this is what my customer need. So that is why this is an amalgamation of these three areas. And that is the core expectation from any product manager, whether you are in startups, whether in any established organization, that is the core expectation from you. But what exactly a PM do? I will cover 3-4 points in that. We try to identify the customer need and build product with the measurable business benefits. When I say customer needs, is basically you're trying to address what is the pain point. Let's say Uber is coming up with the Uber rides. The customer need they might try to solve is affordability. Okay, I want to really solve the affordability point of view. Okay, but also I'm trying to solve is a measurable business benefit. Maybe I'm not getting enough revenue. Maybe I'm not able to tap the correct target segment. So for that, I need to come with a new set of product, which is having some affordability concept. Hence, I'm trying to cover both the benefit, business benefits also, and customer needs also. Measurable is also a very important keyword. Why anything should be measurable? Because we always try to track everything by metrics. So going back to the Swiggy example, whenever they have launched the late night delivery at 11 p.m. delivery, let's say, so what they are trying to solve is how many number of rides we are getting, how many number of orders that we are getting. So that is a kind of metrics that you try to solve on day basis. Second part is to create the product experience. While this you can relate to the net promoter score. So if you have seen any app, you generally app owners ask for give us a rating. So net promoter score says how many of users has given you 5-star rating, minus how many of users are given you 1-star and 2-star rating, divided by overall number of users. So product experience is defined as how much users have affinity to like your product. Maybe they are switching from different competitors to your product. So the increase in traffic can be one of the metric, but overall how the overall experience of the product looks like is one thing that you heavily invest in. Third thing we also try to solve is oversee the performance of already existing product. That is, again, we are very tied with the metrics. So Government of India has put the lockdown on the month of March. Okay. I have recently joined Flipkart. What Flipkart started doing at that point of time is we have started coming up with those categories which was only allowed, which is on the essential product. But we also try to launch such product which were never existed in the market. We have started launching COVID insurance, and the responses that we got from the market was immense. No one thought of that insurance kind of product will be so easily sellable on the e-commerce platform. But because that was a need of the customer, and that was a need, your existing product need changes according with the customer need. So that is what we do, oversee the performance of the product. And if there is some external constraints are there, you try to modify and build an overall experience and improve your existing products. And last part is build the roadmap and vision. This is more like a long-term strategy. Even you're trying to do some short-term fixes, okay, some short features, but overall you should have overall roadmap and you should have vision about your product. Maybe the vision of Netflix is, I want to replace the overall, maybe the first thing that when chill comes to mind, maybe Netflix. That is the kind of product vision that they have. Now to fulfill that vision, they are trying to come up with different categories of themes, different categories of genres. They are trying to have first day, first show kind of things. So kind of modification that you do. And to build your roadmap to fulfill the vision of the product. And while defining that vision, you try to align different stakeholders, your CXOs, that, okay, this is the way forward. This is where we should go in the long run, maybe 2 year down the line, 3 years down the line, but that vision should be very clear. So why PM is needed? This is one of the classic example where I say that what customer has explained it, maybe the three stage the customer has explained it, while project leader was doing something, project leader hasn't understood the complete problem. Analyst has not done their data part and they might come back with some of the data points. Programmers, as usual, they have written something. Then there are business consultants who have painted very rosy picture about their product and they try to sell with this sofa. Okay. And then documentation was not there. Operational installation is not there. We have charged moonshot to the customer. Okay. You are going to charge for this one. And support was not there. And finally you end up with the product, very suboptimal product. So this bridge from here to here is, I think, the core responsibility of the product. Anything which is breaking here. So I have covered various different domains: programmers, analysts, business consultants, documentation, operational teams, technical support, or the customer support. All this is the responsibility where product try to stitch in so that any type of use cases. And then if customer wants to have this kind of swing, this kind of use case, this kind of basic expectation of customer should be met, and there should be no last minute surprises like these. Hence, defining these into three or four different bucket, articulate the need of the customer very clearly. You have to manage your overall product lifecycle, which I think from here to here we have explained. Launch the product and measure the performance. If you're launching this MVP product, there's no harm in launching product like this, but the expectation should be that one day you're going to reach it here. Maybe 3 months down the line, you are okay launching with this. You will test this product and you will improve it to make it like this. Okay. But the expectation is that you should measure the performance, whether this one has any measurement or not, whether this one has any needs or not. If there's no customer, then there's no point in launching this. And if it is not solving any pain point of customer, then there's no point of launching it. And then obviously the ideate and improve the overall life cycle.
Nitesh, I would like to interrupt here, and I have this question in mind, which I'm thinking a lot of people would have, like, how do you actually measure the performance? I mean, if you can just put a glimpse over there on how to measure the performance of the campaign or of the product that you're launching.
Sure. So there is a very popular concept in product where we call this as a North Star metric. North Star metric is generally a one single pointer metric where you can say that my overall product is going well in line. Okay, so maybe for a ride hailing company like Uber or Ola, the North Star metric can be number of rides. Okay, and maybe for companies like Oyo or Airbnb, the North Star metric can be demand per night or sellable rooms per night. Okay, so these are the kind of metric that you articulate. But again, metrics depends on your area and metrics depends on where you're working. So for maybe an operational product manager, the metric can be, I want to reduce the overall TAT, turnaround time for any product escalations. For supply product manager, my metric can be, I want to onboard as many rooms as possible, as quickly as possible. Okay. For on demand side, I want to have how many number of room bookings are happening per day. Okay, so depending on your areas and depending on your product also, your metrics keeps on changing. But yeah, overall North Star metric is one very generic construct in the product world where overall CXO levels track. Okay, that my product is actually getting adapted and actually getting response from the market. Is that your question?
Yeah, it does make sense.
Okay, great. Guys, you can keep on interrupting me at any point of time, wherever you are not clear. So types of PM.
Nitesh, sorry to interrupt again. Since you mentioned about MVP, yeah. Could you tell me at what stage you actually determined, so I have made an MVP? And one more thing additional to that, when you have an MVP in place, does it necessarily go for some beta testing, or can you actually circulate the product for like into a to create a business model? Am I clear with the question, or do you want me to re-articulate it?
No. I think the query is well articulated. I think the decision that you should be taking in MVP for going to MVP, and generally I will give you the very standard answer, but I will also give you the real view, what happening in the real world also. And in generally, what you should be defining your MVP while your whenever your ideation gets complete. Okay, so let's say, for example, you are coming up with the, again going to the Swiggy example, you wanted to launch a food delivery app, okay, but you can't onboard so many delivery executives in all the cities, okay, and also from the feature perspective, you can't launch every category. I can't have an item based browsing. I can have a restaurant based browsing. That means I cannot display on my home screen, I cannot start displaying puri sabji, or maybe I'm not sure pav bhaji starting at the home screen, but eventually I will give them the item based browsing. But in the MVP, I will start showing the restaurant based browsing. Okay, so but that MVP version is generally written at the document at the very start itself. Okay, at 3 months down the line, because overall timeline looks like 7 months or 8 months to launch. But I also want to get some kind of response. So I make like version 1.0 of my product, and in 3 months I'm going to launch let's say restaurant based browsing within one city, because I have sufficient manpower in Delhi. I will going to launch with Delhi. Okay, second part of your query, yes, you should do A/B testing. There are A/B testing, there are beta testings where you try to internally circulate your product also to get the response from the customer. So that is an ideal way you should follow. But having said that, sometimes the decision also happens based on timelines. Let's say if the timeline is getting very stretchy, then you can, okay, let's drop one of the feature, and I will go ahead with 4 to 5 feature only. So that is how you also define MVP sometime in the real world based on the circumstances in the situations. Does that answer your question?
Yes, Nitish, thank you.
Great. So moving on, there are different type of product manager roles also. Nearby roles of product managers. So if you see, I have plotted a graph into strategic and tactical and operation, and then I'm also plotting them into engineering and the sales part. So as I said, because you are interacting with a lot of people, generally on the strategic and the engineering side, here is what the most product manager fits like. But then also on the operational and engineering side, some of the product managers, some of the products are very, very technical, heavy. There you need a technical product managers. So for example, let's say you are owning a fintech platform, fintech product like payment gateways. Now payment gateways are very API based products where on every ping you should get some kind of response. So such type of products comes under technical product manager domain. Then there are also a combination of sales and the operation. So there are this company called, you must have heard about it, FreeCharge. Okay, so whenever they build some kind of product launch, they first ask product manager to go to the market and sell it to at least one client. So that is their model, and that is where you are very close to the sales product campaign. So sales product manager also. Generally, product manager also has a product sales team also where they pitch their product. So product manager closely work with sales, product sales guys. And then there are product marketeer. This is one of the very key, very evolving field and very rapidly in demand also now, because once a product gets launched, how the product should get adopted. Okay, I have reached out to 100 customer. How will I reach out to 1 lakh customer? This requires marketing, this required Google AdWords, this required Facebook marketing. All such things are closely linked with the product marketing guys, and that is where they're fitting here. So skill sets, generally what industry is looking at currently, there are five different skill sets: soft skills, technical skill, leadership skill, market research, and affinity towards data. I will relate these skill sets to also the kind of product interviews, the product rounds that happens by in your interviews. I will come back to that later, but elaborating on the skill set, when we say skills are soft skills, we are looking for a strong communication skill and a strong negotiation skills. Because I think whenever you're interacting day to day with your stakeholder and when you are keeping it, no, this customer needs this kind of data, this customer needs this kind of feature, such things require a lot of negotiation. You have to hard push people, no, we are not ready by 3 months, or you have to push your engineering people ki, we will be ready, we have to be ready by 3 months because they will push in timeline. So such kind of things require very strong communication and very strong negotiation. And that is what is the primary responsibility. Then going to the technical skills, tech background and tech enthusiasts are always welcome. You should have an affinity towards at least some kind of technical knowledge, because otherwise this field will be very boring for you because you have to interact with engineers day to day. So I think at least tech enthusiasm should be there. But again, this is not a very hard bound skill. Leadership. I think that is one of the most important, where you can see a conflict resolution, how you handle conflict resolution, how you are going to handle the stakeholder management. I think these are some of the situational question people will put you in and will try to ask whether you are possessing these two kind of skills or not. Market research, any kind of project, if you have done something on the market research, is always helpful, whether you are understanding users and their pain point. And I think this is one of the key thing. If you can, there are so many needs. Well, while you are driving the car, you must have seen that why the clutch and accelerator and brake are at the downside, and why can't a car stop while if you sleep. And that is where I think the concept of autonomous driving is coming. But this is a pain of the customer. Now, if you can solve the pain of the customer via some feature, via some tech word, via some intelligence, that is, I think, the most important contribution that you can do. And that is why I think this point of understanding users and their pain point is the key of success. And the last is affinity towards data. If you can understand the metrics, if you can quantify the problem, if you can prioritize them, I think that is also one of the skill set that people are looking at. Then PM career path and opportunities. There are two major track that how PMs are currently getting hired in India, at least. There are associate product manager role, and then there are product management one and product management two roles. Associate PM role is generally at the undergrad level, an entry role where you are mapped with one of the product owners, and they interact, they groom you into the full-fledged PM1 and PM2 role. So this like you will be in the under mentorship with one of the product manager. You will partially own of the one of the product, not if not fully, you'll at least partially own few of the features of that. PM1 and two is generally the post-grad roles, but having said that, we have seen other exceptions also, and where you are getting an ownership one of the products. So there may be 15 to 20 different product line, and PM1 will be owning one of their product line. Okay, then there's a part to senior product manager, and it eventually transform to group product manager, and eventually it goes to director of product. Every product, and it goes higher in hierarchy. I will not go deep into it, but yeah, the overall idea is as you grow, there are multiple products. It will start getting added to your charter. You'll start getting multiple mentorship roles. As a group product manager, you are start defining the product strategy, and you are also defining the leadership role. And director of product is generally when you are aligning the leadership and the CXOs. And this is where you will define overall long-term roadmap. Okay, what exactly should we solve? What are the kind of things we should invest as a company? So that is, I think, the leadership role eventually comes in, and eventually this DOP becomes VP, SVPs, and sometimes CXOs. PM hiring trends in India. I will just quickly glance through it. So this slide is very incomplete. So if you just see, my slide got built, but I could see so many industries which is not here. Mobility, Uber, Ola. There are industries like food tech. There are industries like which we cannot fit into some kind of bucket. But still, I will give at least these five buckets, which is actually hiring very actively in India. E-com is obviously in the boom. So Amazon, Flipkart, Deliveries, all these companies are becoming like, they are growing very crazily, especially after the lockdown. The trends are like 50-60% of sales are there up, and adoption into their platform is up by 20-30%. And this trend will continue as we see with Jio phenomena coming in. This trend will keeps on continuing at least for some point of time. So this is where I think the boom of e-com is coming up. And then there are media companies who are traditional media companies who are trying to convert them into full-fledged platform of digital media now. Times Internet has TUI.com, HT Media has HTmedia.com. Everything I think today's word, everyone has .com word. Okay. And also apart from .com, they're also trying to build some additional delta features, like HT Media is coming up with their woman-centric healthcare magazine. So fully digital, so that working women can access them. So these are the kind of media platform which is coming in. Content is a different domain. I think content is one very interesting piece, and where the most fight will be there. Netflix, Disney Hotstar, Wink Music, Gaana.com, so many of them are here, which we will not fit into. And I think this is where all the traffic it is currently. So subscription-based platform, free platform is, I think, they are gaining a lot of momentum. Fintech is, I think, India has the success story. We have one of our own product, Tej, which got globalized into Google Pay. Paytm has done some of the success, and PhonePe. So all of them are unicorns now, and they are actively hiring in their own domains. And then there are SaaS companies where Microsoft, AWS, Salesforce, all of them are also looking out. But as I said, this slide is very incomplete. There are so many companies which are looking out, and so many PMs which are in demand. Guys, I will just take a pause here. So that will, before going to the product use cases, I want to check if you want to have any doubt about the basics of product management.
Anyone can
talk to me. Yes, Kaji. Yeah. Actually, I have a question for you. I recently entered into this OTT platform, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to understand how the product vision and roadmap for that particular product would be. It's very early for Flipkart to get into that, and there are clients like Amazon Prime. So wanted to understand how the product vision for this and what is the roadmap.
Sure. So I am not currently directly involved in the OTT platform, but I know what is the kind of vision that we are looking at. At the end, Flipkart has their own. So what we have realized with this Prime comes into, with Amazon Prime comes into, what Prime is helping them is not only in terms of content, but they are also helping in terms of retention. Because if you have buy a subscription of Amazon Prime, which is just 99 rupees a month, or I'm not sure what's up their current price, 999 a year, but the value that customer is getting is so cheap, and apart from that, the brand recall. So if we have also done some kind of surveys also, what we are also observing is a brand recall. So if you compare between Amazon and Flipkart, we'll say, okay, Amazon is coming very right in front of them whenever they are thinking about shopping. And this, some part of this we can attribute towards Prime, because Prime is, I think, they are watching day to day basis. There is the Amazon Prime coming. Okay, you can watch this show as Amazon Prime. So, but Amazon word is very highly recalled in that. Okay, they have also tapped to a new customers also, which they couldn't earlier, because Amazon is very strong in metro cities, but not so strong in tier two. But these, because of obviously this fintech boundary line, because so many people are not currently having credit card or debit card, but they still are using Prime, and the people are seeing that there is a certain kind of additional, some of the customers are onboarding the Amazon platform due to this factor of Prime. So I think that is one of the Prime cases, how you can reach out to the next set of customer, how you can build that momentum of engagement, and overall eventually we'll monetize it, but you can obviously, that monetization should also contribute to your core business. So Flipkart will remain a core supply chain, a core e-commerce company. But if any kind of thing which is helping and helping them to reach out to more set of customer, I think any company should venture into that domain.
Cool. Can I just take one moment and kind of thank Mr. Vivek Shah to join the webinar today? He is ex-AVP of Hotstar. So I think if you have some questions regarding content and product management, he is the guy to be reached out. Thank you so much, sir, for joining. I didn't expect you that you would join the session.
Hey, Vivek, thanks for joining.
Please go on. This is exciting. Thank you so much.
It's always good to have another product guy joins. Yeah, please.
Can you talk about how an ideal product roadmap should look like?
Okay, sure. Before going into that, should we go into product use case first? Because I think the first thing that I want to address is how you will approach that, and maybe based on that, we'll start the roadmap part also. Does that make sense?
Sure. And I had another question, what kind of decision making power do you have as in the PM role? Who are you answerable to, and do you get to make day-to-day decisions? And I just want to know who you work under and who are you guiding?
Okay, sure. So I think this is the slide. PM1 and PM2 generally work under SPMs, and SPM works under GPM. I have worked into both of these roles, and we eventually report to GPMs, which eventually report to DOP. But there are very flat hierarchy also in some of the companies, where we also report directly to the VPs also. But in terms of decision making, I think as a product manager, you have to do a lot of negotiation. You have to do a lot of stakeholder management. But at the end, you are the owner of the product. If you say you have to sign off for everything, let's say if your business owner comes up and says that you have to launch next product set within 15 days. Okay. But and even if it is not delivering any value to the customer, the problem is not the timeline, 15 days, what value we are delivering. If you are not delivering any value, I think as upfront, you should say 15 days, whatever feature you're launching is not correct. Let's take 45 days and build the correct product feature, which at least solve one of the pain points. So I think that is the kind of ownership PM1s, PM2s, or SPM, sorry, PM has. If you take a stand, and I think the stand is not in terms of sales, stand is not in terms of engineers or the tech architect. The stand is in terms of what is the value you are adding to the customer, and that you have a full ownership. I think you are the best person who should take this stand.
Got it, thanks.
Yeah. So going to the product use cases, we'll cover.
Barbunan here. So again, I just have a question. Let's say we are in a planning stage, all right? So we have a product. There's a problem that we are supposed to solve, and after that, after understanding the problem, I come up with certain solution. Mm-hmm. Then I look into, I know what is my company's capability and resources. According to that, I provide the solution. So this could be one case. So in this particular stage, how does it actually happen? Whether I make certain choices, next I have to take this thing to the tech team. So should I, will I be making choices and going to the tech team, or will I bring the tech team in making these choices? Whether this product could be made with this capability and resources.
So the way I look at it is, at the planning stage itself, you should build your roadmap in the way like MVP, full-fledged feature, maybe a comp pack of a feature, okay, short-term feature, short-term roadmap, short-term, long-term roadmap kind of thing. At the planning stage itself, this has to be very well documented. Okay. And then, so whenever you think through, we are writing product requirement docs also, PRDs, the primary expectation from that PRD is you should be defining end-to-end flow, and it's okay to launch a certain set with a sub-optimized flow, with a very limited set of flow. Okay. You can solve something operationally. You can solve something via marketing. Those things are fine, but you should be defining it at least at the very stage. Okay. And then you can talk with your other engineering stakeholders, and they say, okay, this will take 6 months. Then you can take a call. 6 months, you cannot wait because business has to grow, right? So then you can say, okay, we'll launch these two. We'll go back to our plan A and plan B and plan C, and we'll launch with these two features only. And this is the expected revenue. This product feature will bring in. Hope that answers your query.
Sorry. So as a product manager, I should be very much thorough with my capabilities and resources. According to that, I have to make the decision and then go to the tech team.
Yes, that is one. But I would upfront say you should not get constrained yourself by the capabilities. Capability is the company's problem. Let's say you come up with something, okay, that required a full-fledged road feature revamp, okay, but you don't have front-end engineers, you don't have a feature revamp people, then what can you do? You can outsource them all the time. You can do some kind of, you don't have designers, you can always go and outsource them. So that is a kind of secondary problem that you will face. I agree that the kind of constraint that you should always put into while implementation part. But at the ideation part, I think you should not be worried about kind of constraint that you have. Obviously, not going beyond company philosophy. Maybe Flipkart don't want to do some kind of content, that is fine. But within company philosophy, you should define your ideation without any constraint.
Thanks, Nitish. Perfect.
Sure. So guys, I will quickly cover some of the product use cases. I guess we are running short of time. So this is one of the GoPro video. I will just play it for you guys. Let me know if you can see.
Yes.
Can you see?
Yes.
So coming back to the slide, I guess, where is it? Yeah. Guys, can you see?
Yes.
Okay. Yep. So the reason that I have kept this slide, in spite of this is not a very digital product, exactly fitting it, but it's one of the products that I like. But I want you to guys to think through, let's be like a GoPro product manager. While they were building this hero product, maybe what are the kind of things that they might have thought through while building this kind of product? First thing we should ask is, who are our target audience? Whom are we building this product? I think for target audience, for these kind of product, which is a little expensive, maybe the adventure enthusiasts and travelers. Okay. And here also you can dissect maybe a scuba divers, maybe I'm not sure, bikers. There are different kind of user personas that we build. So first you define target audience, then you try to start building user personas and did that. Then you try to solve what are the user pain points. Why you're launching this product? Maybe the things that they are trying to cover is on the move videos and photo qualities. Currently, with the normal cameras, the photo qualities and video qualities are pretty blurry. Okay, that is one of the class apart feature that they have built with this one of their Be a Hero GoPro product. Robustness, because you are moving on different planes, on the mountains, on the bike. So such kind of mobility solution requires a very robust body of the entire product. Then you should be always environmental resistance also, because we are exposing to different kind of thing. Also, one of the things that they are trying to solve is limited eyesight view and nighttime view. Because while if you have seen that in such situations when you are in scuba diving, when you're doing air skydiving, in such all kind of things, the minutes that it is there, it's I think 40 seconds or 50 seconds, or maybe 10 seconds. And for your if there are eye time, the time is even shorter. So maybe the time that they want to enhance that with 360 view, with different kind of views, whether if we can give them the experience which they can remember for the lifetime. And I think that is one of the USP they are trying to solve. So I have just given some random ideas. Again, I didn't work for GoPro, but I think that is how you should approach any problem. Any kind of product use cases comes up. And that is why I have also kept one more use case, which is Uber. And Uber Rideshare is, I think, one of the product that I want to bring in. And I want to ask you guys, like, what is the target audience, do you think, whenever Uber is launched Rideshare, what is the kind of target audience they might be having in mind? Whom they are building the Uber Rideshare?
Working class, guys.
So I have heard working class. Who else? What else?
Who don't want to spend more money on a trip.
Okay, a hotel. Okay.
College students.
Anyone else? No, but I think you guys have covered, I think.
Environment-friendly people.
Environment-friendly, may or may not, because they still have diesel car. Maybe they will go to EV sometime. But again, I think you have covered a lot of points. Budget travelers, students, daily commuters. These are the target audience they might have thought through. And trade-off is obviously time versus money. Okay. But what are the pain point they are solving? Is that the only pain point they are solving? When you say the Uber has two, it's a three-dimension world. They have riders, they have driver, but they also have their own business metrics. They also want to fill their own money also. Okay. So the objective is to attract new customer segment and improve their retention, because it's difficult if you're riding once in a month and instead if you start riding 5 days in a month, obviously your overall retention will improve, because overall interaction with Uber day on day basis will increase. You will start maximize your revenues during your peak hour and cut short the wait time also, because you'll start frequently getting cabs more often during those peak hours. Because now more people are sharing very limited set of cab. But the most important point is riders, because the supply side is not so scalable in India. And this is one of the most important concepts, increasing drivers and car owners' value. And because that is how I think most of the business are in India, like whether it's OYO, whether it's Ola, whether it's Uber. If you have supply and if you can bring value to that supply chain, I think demand is anyway shorter. We are 1 billion plus people. Generally, demands are pretty okay, but if you can solve the supply issues, increasing drivers and car owners' value, that means people, the car owners will stop sharing their car in Ola, and they will start pushing it to Uber till the time Ola will not come with the Ola ride also, and they eventually come. And obviously improving Uber's revenue, because with the same set of cab, they're getting more revenue, they could fulfill more riders, they're getting more attention. So this is a win-win situation for riders, drivers, and Uber. But the point I want to make is, while solving any product use cases, think about the user persona, think about the kind of problems they are solving. You're not solving only for demands, which is riders, you're also solving for supply, which is drivers. and also your own business metrics. What are the max peak revenue maximization? There may be one of the metric that you should be tracking and you might be max, you want to maximize. Going to the PM interviews, kind of thing and kind of rounds that PM generally goes through. And this is true generally for experience products or whenever you're trying to switch from one field to other, but also the same format and the same kind of skill set is applicable on for the freshers also. So one of the things they are looking at is problem solving. If you can understand the user needs and pain point, I cannot emphasize enough on this point. And the structured thinking. While solving the problem, you should be very methodological while giving your answers. Maybe like here, like in this, you should first approach, okay, here is my audience. Here are the problem, five problems for the riders. Here are the five problems for the drivers. And here are the three problems for the Uber. And then you start building the feature around it. But first define the problem, define it very structurally. And I think that is one of the things that in the interviews you can expect. Second part is product design. If you can design, if you have a good design thinking and kind of thing that they ask is design a homepage, listing page. So that is a, one of the skill that they are trying to test. Analytics, you should be good with numbers, guesstimates and metrics. There are a lot of guesstimate they ask. Number of cars in Delhi, guess the number of weddings in India, guess the number of mobile phones you are selling in one day. So this kind of question that you come up, the idea is not to guess the correct answer. Idea is how you're going to approach the problem and how you're going to approach. Sometime for the experience product also, they are just given metrics. Okay, my overall room prices are dropping. Guess what can be the, no, that is the only problem. Now you have to define the feature and you have to define what can be the solution for those. Okay, so those kind of things you bombard with. And the skill is obviously the quantification of problems that they are looking at. So if you can quantify the problem, you can obviously prioritize it well. Last, I think this fourth skill is the engineering fitment. As I said, you should be tech enthusiast. If you can, and one of the thing is prioritization and planning, because engineering bandwidth is always limited. You will never get enough engineers to solve lot of things which your business wants and lot of things which you want to solve. So if you can prioritize it well and if you can plan it well, that is one thing we are looking at. So comfort with technology is one part of it, one aspect of it people look for. And last is product strategy. This is the very this is where I think if you can make a correct decision, if you can show the leadership, then the kind of question they might ask is, should we enter Delhi? Should Swiggy enter Delhi or not? Should Amazon enter content business or not? Should Microsoft buy Slack or not? Kind of question that what they are looking is not the, again, yes and no answer, but maybe if you can define what and why, I think that is the thing people are looking at. And I think that is how the structure of the interviews are also defined. Different people take your different interviews and that is how you are judged on these 5-6 skills. So I think I've covered most of the point. If you have any questions on slides, or happy to take up questions.
One question that we have lying in the chat box is, can you please tell us what matrices are important to track the SaaS model? Let's take the example of Dynamics 365 or Salesforce.
Sure. So SaaS will have a different, I would say different, within SaaS, there will be a different product line. And so SaaS is just software as a service, is very generic. Microsoft is in SaaS business, but they have a different product line also. Now within SaaS also, within one product also, there may be a different product that you might be tracking, and every product might have a different purpose. One of them, but one of the very good thing you can always say is onboarding more and more customers. Because if you can onboard more customers, that means obviously more customers are adopting and at least you're getting good response from the market. And I think that is one of the very key aspect to if that you're solving good customer experience, at least one of the point.
Possibly. Any good certification or sources to improve your PM skills? Any such leads for students?
Yeah, guys, I was thinking of that. So I have not done anything there are different certification I think in the Coursera that is coming up. I think there's a Harvard business certification also there, which is good. But I think I will add one more slide for you guys. I was running short of time, but I will add one slide where I can add more interview content. If not a certification, I think you should read this one book for Case in Point. I think it will build your overall how you should approach a problem. Yeah, how I should come back with an idea. I think that is one of the book you guys should read. And apart from there is also one product use case book. I think that also you should read. I will add those links in this slide.
Great. Any freelancing options or for product management roles? One. Second, how should a person from another domain would plan to shift to this role?
Freelancing options are many. If you are preferably looking for freelancing, that means you have certain experience in this field. I think now, because this field is very recent in India. I think 2011, 2012, people have started thinking about it, and recently companies started hiring. So currently the demand is very high, and that is how people are started sharing. So this one company called Fab Hotel, they have reached out for freelancing opportunities. So how they share is they have this 2 days schedule. So they hire some external product for 2 days and they work with them on the weekend. But I think that is the kind of freelancing opportunities that you guys will have if you'll excel into it. Second point is about Apurva, sorry,
shifting from other domains like marketing or finance or some other domain that you're working currently and you want to.
Yeah, I think that is very fair. I think people have this industry is very adaptive. Product marketing people have very recently switched to product management. I've seen all sort of people, even business people started switching into product management. So I think, because skill set is still evolving, this industry is very evolving in nature, I think you still have a very low barrier. And this is, I think, a very good point. If you want to switch into, you have to prepare your profile accordingly. You have to show some kind of projects. You have done some market research. You have done some kind of, you may be an engineer in the background. So such kind of thing, I think you can show and you will get you can switch into it very easily.
Another question is more like a common one.
Can you talk?
Sorry.
Sure, go ahead.
So my question was, which I've received from audience, was how COVID has kind of changed the semi-fear for product management.
How COVID has changed
the skeptical or the view for product management.
Oh, it has changed. I have seen it. So like product managers loved COVID. The way I see it is every digital adoption that you see, whether it's Flipkart, you talk with any product manager, Flipkart, content, food, everywhere the business went up the roof. There was an initial hiccup when government has imposed, we are the country having very harshest lockdown, but post that the results are phenomenal. People, even we have recently conducted this big billion day sale, and Amazon has also conducted their own sale. The numbers are pretty amazing, and given people are losing job, people don't have a money, still the kind of responses that you are getting, and especially the content is anyways, every second person is now into the content space. So I think product managers have sounded like an opportunity rather than like a peer. So yeah, that's my take. Yeah.
Go ahead, Sahil.
Can you talk more about the technical skills which would be required? And another question is, as you mentioned that the product manager has a lot of aspects, be it in design or the technical skills or the marketing skills. So how does one become a master of all these traits?
Tough question. So first part I can answer easily. Technical skill is not very hard bound, Sahil. If the two aspect, I again repeat that what they are looking at. One is if you can prioritize the problem well, your engineering bandwidth will always be choked. How can you prioritize and you can articulate it well? I think that is the one thing that in the engineering fitment they are looking at. If you can quantify your problems well, I think that is one point. And second point, tech enthusiast. You should be understanding, okay, there's an Apple 7 launch. They will ask you what is the kind of 3 feature set. You should always tell. So that gives you, okay, this guy is having some kind of tech enthusiasm. Some of the companies also put certain criteria. If you have 1 year of engineering experience, so you have 1 year of that. But I think those are very few. So more or less it is open. Second query, I think Sahil, can you repeat?
Yeah, so I was talking about the different flavors of being a product manager. So you have to be a good tech-enabled guy, and you have to be a good marketer. You have to be a good sales person, and I guess maybe a good finance person. So how do you manage all of that?
So Sahil, you cannot, I will say anyone cannot be master of all of them, but you should have a flavor of all of them, and you will have all the helping hand. So maybe I have run a lot of SQL queries to get the data, but that's not the case always. You get a product analyst where you can ask for the data and then you can track it. You have very automated dashboard. You can always ask the business person, okay, what is the target that we are seeing? What is the kind of sales that we are seeing? Instead of you defining it, you should be co-owning with them. Then on the compliance side, okay, there are tax regulation is coming up. Now government has started imposing this TCS and TDS. Yeah, you might not know, there's a recent tax deduction at source started happening at e-commerce. So for them, tax people will help you. So that is like a lot of collaborative work. Rather than you are mastering everything, you go to the domain owners, you get the knowledge, and then you build their own product. But you are the owner of that. You build the correct product, whatever, based on the knowledge you got from the different stakeholders.
Understood.
Cool. So I guess, guys, I know we are running out of time. Apurva, any other query you want to put in?
So I think I open to the audience itself, because whatever questions I have received, we have kind of covered them in the presentation itself. So any questions, any open questions, you can either ask him here or you can write back to us. So we are waiting for.
If you don't mind, can you talk about how lucrative is the role money wise?
Yeah. That I should have covered the start of the slide. Product managers is one of the highest paying profiles currently in India. It's pretty close to consultants. Even we are outperforming consultants also nowadays, because consultant now, it's not just McKinsey, Bain, Boston. Obviously they are rich people, but product manager is an overall, if you see the average salary, if you just go on LinkedIn and just try to get this answer, you will get to know what I'm saying. It is one of the highest paying job, because obviously the domain knowledge is limited currently. People are limited, and also salaries are pretty good. I think it's better than the industry average, much better than industry.
Yeah. Another question, like, does an MBA help for you becoming a product manager?
Yes, sir. Without doubt. Yes. There are certain criteria also some companies put for MBAs. Some of them are open for engineers also, but for MBA, one of the route is companies do visit the campus also, but also one of the route is you get more chances to be eligible for such kind of roles, and then you can directly do PM1 and PM2 roles instead of APM roles.
The specialization should be in marketing, right?
Not necessarily. Again, not a very hard bound. But marketing makes more sense, because you're more closer to the user, more closer to the, if you want to do finance, then finance may be more closer to bank. But having said that, again, there are financial product owners also, where you are launching fintech platform, maybe finance is one of the domain. I myself have currently working into the Wall Street. Wall Street is a team which tracks all the money movement. So there are so many financial jargon. I wish I would have taken finance during my MBA. So I said it like that domain is very wide. It's not necessary that you should have marketing or finance.
Yeah, because also adding to what Nitesh is talking about. So I am working at IDFC First Bank, and we have a complete product management role out there for MBA students. So where people go out and they talk about complete financial products, they manage, mm-hmm. they create new product, and then they go ahead with the marketing plan also. So it's more an income passing role for marketing and finance. But the master's in finance is more required to have that knowledge about the product and onto how you want to create the product. So it's more like a balancing job there.
So that is a good point, Purva. I have actually skipped the entire banking product. There's so many banks are coming up, so many products.
A lot.
The world, entire Modi's campaign of digitalization, everyone is coming up with their own product line. So product managers are very necessary there.
Correct. right. Like we are, the banks and fintech people, they are just hiring a lot of product management guys these days.
Correct.
Does it also make easier for you to start something of your own later in your career if you are in a PM role?
Yeah, I have seen this trend. A lot of PMs become their startup founder, then they switch, they also come back and join PM. So I'm not sure it does it easier, but there is a catch. There's a willingness to start doing that. It, the role makes you more doer, I guess, and that is how people are switching, and you're exploring digital options also, because the first hand experience, so many things are not yet solved. So I think that is how people are becoming more and more co-founders also.
Okay.
Nitesh, I have a question.
So
I guess like most of us will be getting to experience pre-sales role, and I heard you saying that you came from pre-sales role to product management. So how was your journey, and what are skill set which you experienced in pre-sales was helpful in product management?
I think just a minute, guys. My laptop is getting discharged. So I think when I started at the pre-sales, that was during my engineering job, because I was owning one of the product there also. We are designing the octa-core solution, one of the first solution that we have designed, for the first chipset in the world. And then I started pitching to a different client. How it helped is whenever I started talking about it, they always see it as a valuable skill set, because they know that if you have done sales now, that means you have interacted firsthand with your customer, and that is a big plus. Like no one will deny this, that you get a natural advantage over any other person while you are appearing for the interview. All you need to add some of the skill set, maybe structured thinking, maybe some of the product certification, some of the market research product, but that is an easier part. But the kind of help that it gets is immense. Does that answer your question? Very good.
Nitesh, can you also talk about an ideal product roadmap?
Yeah, I think I have missed that. So the ideal product roadmap, there is no very short answer to it, and I may not be the very perfect person to answer it also, but I will still attempt at it. The ideal product roadmap should cover what you're trying to achieve. For example, 1 year down the line, you wanted to be the number one content provider. Okay, let's say Amazon Prime has taken up this target. Okay, now what all is required to achieve it? Okay, first of all, how you're defining it to be number one content provider, maybe based on number of traffic, maybe based on number of subscription, maybe based on number of revenue, overall revenue, you should define that metric. And now what all is required? Okay, what all is required? Maybe, okay, I will launch first day, first show products. I will launch different themes and different categories. I will launch IMDb ratings. I will give more visibility. I will make discovery much more simpler. I will have some value-added subscription platform where this subscription can also be used in flight booking. Anything is required. You define whatever things are required, and to achieve that. But at the end of the 1 year, when your CXO will ask you that, where are we? So here are the, and for that what I'm saying is just 15 line item, and within the one line item there will be 10 to 12 different subtasks also, and that is how you build your entire roadmap. And then you start prioritizing, okay, this feature will give me 10 crore, this feature will give me 100 plus traffics. That is how you start mapping that, and once that table is finalized, you started implementing it. So that is how we define our product roadmap. We ideate, we brainstorm, and then we come back with our roadmaps.
Sounds good.
Cool. Any other query?
I don't think so. Do we have some more questions?
What would you recommend someone who's trying to transit to a PM role? Like, this question is already asked, but I still want to know, like, if someone is moving from a finance role, he has no background in PM. So what essential skills should he take before sitting for an interview?
So I think you should read a lot. I think in the start, you should read some of the few recommended, like Case in Point, some of the books like Product Use Cases. That is one. Point two, your resume should talk about it. I have not taken any explicit slide on the resume, but if your resume should talk about your market research product, resume should talk about what are the kind of initiative that we have taken, because people love the leadership and the initiative part. And the third part is the tech enthusiasm. That I think you can cover during the interview, that you have done some coding, maybe you want to highlight that, or maybe you have process optimization. Process optimization is also one of the key aspect of product managers also. So if you have done that, you can always show in some kind of small projects if you have done, if you can show it well, I think people are most welcome there.
I think I would just like to add a bit, since I am working closely with the product managers in, at least in banks. So these people are more, since they have a background of finance, so they can kind of put the product in a better position in terms of the customer centricity, in terms of how they want to market the product. So I think if you have a good hold on your financial concepts, that will also help you to get through an interview. At least it will give you a chance to get into an interview. And rest what Nitesh said always remains valid, that you have to be a bit high on technical, because a product manager at a financial service will not be only talking about finance. He has to have a sense of tech, at least in terms of he should be like comfortable with talking about coding or talking about seeing coding and, you know, implement the changes in the backend side.
Data, what about the data analysis tools like SQL and R?
But that is not necessary, Sahil. It is not that hard and fast. You should know SQL, you should know R. But while solving guesstimate, you should know that how many cars are in Delhi, but at least you should be approaching it well. That is, I think, skill, but not necessary. You should. I was not aware about SQL before this company, but yeah, you will learn it. That is, they will make you learn. But it says you should be well comfortable with the data and number crunching.
Yeah, I think if you know what to get from where, you can find your path in any software. I mean, there are people who work for you, so finding that path is not difficult. It's just that you should know what you really need from that data. I think that's the more short about it. Gautam, you were saying something.
Yeah, Nitesh, like this is apart from the product management part. Like, I recently heard that Flipkart has acquired a augmented reality firm, Scape, I guess. So can we expect augmented reality or virtual reality feature being put into this Flipkart platform for us to virtually try on the products that is being listed there?
So that's always the plan, Gautam. I guess people and different companies are trying it, not only Flipkart. If you heard of it long back, I think 3 years back or 2 years back, Jabong has launched that virtual trial room. Just like Lenskart has launched that specs, na, you can do that.
Yeah.
Jabong has also launched a virtual trial room for female audience, because they have seen that, sorry Purva, but they have seen that the return rates are very high in the, for the female category. So to solve that problem, they wanted to have a virtual trial option. Unfortunately, it was not very successful. They might will come back with some of the feature set in the later stage. So augmented reality is, I think, the way forward. It will be a little slow because machine learning and ML and AI models are still evolving. But I think, yeah, no doubt about it, they are coming up with a plethora of features.
Yeah, and one more small question, Nitesh. Like, I recently read about this headless technology, like using an IoT devices, people will be ordering their groceries or something like that without any front end. There will be only a back end function which helps you in ordering and getting the things done. Mm-hmm. So, like being Flipkart is also in the same e-commerce platform. Can this also be expected in future or?
Yeah, I think they have launched this voice-enabled VIP ordering management system, where you can just place an order, Ata 1kg, and Ata 1kg will get added to your cart and it will shipped also. But that end-to-end voice-enabled module is there. Having said that, this is what kind of user they are solving. Maybe they are solving the very not tech-savvy, maybe our uncles, our aunties. But we are very daily interacting on the user platform on the mobile, or maybe we are so addicted to mobile that we find it so easy. But I've seen Alexa response. Maybe first of all, the overall voice enablement response should be very good. Alexa is not understanding a lot of things, and then I start getting frustrated, and I start ordering by phone directly. I started switching the songs very frequently on by my phone only. So, I agree with you, Gautam, that eventually that is the one path overall tech industry will take, not in terms of e-commerce, but it will come into mobility also. Stop the car, start the car, such kind of use cases will come out.
Thank you.
Oh, I think one question that we have in the chat section is regarding openings for PM role. Someone is saying that LinkedIn listings, they mostly ask for a prior experience. And then so that where an MBA graduate person can go with no prior experience for jobs.
There are PM fresher opportunities also there. I agree that PM fresher opportunities are little less as compared to the experience. But PM fresher opportunity, there are PM schools. So there are different forums also. I will search. I am also not currently aware. But there I have seen that different forums where specifically for the PMs, they list down few of the opportunities. If I can find such pages, I will definitely share it with you guys.
Got it. I think we are covered. Any other question? I think it's quite late for the session to continue. But still, if you want to talk to Nitesh, we're more than happy.
Very enthusiastic crowd.
Thanks for your time, guys.
This marks the end for the episode today. It was really great hearing out insights and about your experience specifically for PM. And I think this is one of the most touted roles in today's time. And that's why a lot of people have come back and asked for us to get a PM guy on board. And finally, thank you for fulfilling that position as well for us.
My pleasure, Apurva. My pleasure.
So in case you have any doubts, guys, or any questions, you can simply ping to us or to Nitesh directly on his LinkedIn. Any other suggestions are more than welcome. And thank you for joining today. Good night.
Thank you, guys. Good night.
Thank you, Apurva. Thank you, Nitesh.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.